Hi, I'm Lisa Bisbee. I'm an artist, and today on Art Talk, we're going to be talking with Erin Baker Edgar. And Erin is a singer, and she's going to be headed to Carnegie Hall in New York City. I'm so excited for you, Erin.
Thank you, Lisa.
Oh, you're welcome. So do you want to jump right in and give me a little soundtrack?
Oh, my goodness. You want me to do it at the very beginning?
I want to hear.
You want all the cool stuff now. Okay.
Yeah.
Well, let me give you one soundtrack.
And, okay.
Let's see. And he will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of his hand.
Erin, that was beautiful.
That is a Catholic hymn from one of the official Catholic hymnals. And the hymn itself is called On Eagle's Wings, and it references the, I believe it's 23rd chapter of Isaiah, when they talk about God being somebody who bears you up on his wings.
Oh, my friend just piped in. Veronica says it was sung at her wedding, and she says beautiful. She put her hands up to say beautiful. Thanks, Veronica.
Thank you, Veronica. That song is very special to me. I sang the song at the funerals of each of my four grandparents.
Oh, that's just sweet. That's really sweet. Well, I want to go ahead and talk about what your journey is like to get to Carnegie Hall. Right now I have a picture of Carnegie Hall, the interior, and it's got the stage with the grand piano. You're not going alone. You're going with a group. So let's hear about your group.
So when I was very young, I had the dream of going to Carnegie Hall. And I thought, you know, this is a dream that's closed to me. I'm not a musician or special or famous. And in late November, early December, just out of the blue, the North Carolina Master Chorale, I'm a member of that, we got an email just on our mailing list. And it was from a gentleman who had composed a piece of music, and he was looking for singers. I just couldn't resist. It's a, you know, my lifelong dream is coming true. What am I going to do? So singers are pulled from that group, and then also from local churches around Raleigh, North Carolina. We're all going together.
So after you got June. The email, Erin, how long did it take you to decide yes or no?
About 2 minutes. Well, 30 seconds. I did my husband the courtesy of going and telling him I would be going to Carnegie Hall. But really, within like 15 or 30 seconds after that email was sent to me, I decided this is going to be something I will be doing next year.
Oh, this is awesome. So right now I found an old vintage photograph of Carnegie Hall. This is a real landmark in New York City. Some of the big wigs of all time have ever played there. And so you had this dream, you're a little girl. What do you have to say to all those little ones out there who are dreaming up their big dreams?
Well, to all the little ones, whether you're little in body or spirit, no matter how old you are, if you have a dream, no matter how big it is, keep a place open in your heart for that dream to come in, because you never know when you will have just the right opportunity come to you to fulfill your dream.
But it wasn't just dreaming, Erin. You took steps all along the way to get there.
That's true. I believe that everyone with a big dream always takes steps if they've got space for that in their heart and it's guiding them, even if they don't know it. You take steps to get your dreams fulfilled. So when I was young and I had that dream, I started singing. I was singing in my church. I was singing in the children's choir. I was taking voice lessons. I got to college. I took more voice lessons. Even though I thought Carnegie Hall was behind me, I was singing in choirs and groups. And if I hadn't joined the North Carolina Master Chorale and sung with this composer, his name is Michael Glasgow, I don't think I would be going to Carnegie Hall right now. In fact, I know I wouldn't be.
Well, I spoke with Michael this morning, and he actually mentioned that you have a very unique way of creating music. So can you tell us a little bit about your, I guess not procedure, but the way you create, the way you create music? How do you go about it?
So it kind of is a procedure. I am a very good mimic, so I replay what I hear, and so I hear it, and it comes into my head, you know, from wherever, whether it's something that, some music that I'm creating myself, or whether it's music that I hear, and I can sing it back, or, you know, play it back if I'm playing on the piano or something. But that's how I learn the best, and it's like a gestalt. So in order to really get the sense of the music that I'm going to be singing, I almost need to hear it all at one time, all the parts together, you know, the orchestra and the singers and their blend together to understand it. It's like I can, the complete puzzle is in front of me, and then I can put my part into it.
Well, Erin, it's really interesting because you've got this whole creative side of your personality, but yet you are a lawyer. You have a, you're in the legal profession. You have your own law firm. So, mm-hmm. So you're using both your left side of the brain and the right side of the brain. Tell us a little bit. So you're the lawyer who.
So I'm the lawyer who likes to hear all sides of an argument and pick the best one and according to, you know, the law and the procedure and what the rules are. But I'm also the lawyer who likes to find the flexibility in those rules and think outside the box, perhaps, and serve the world in that sort of right-brained, big picture way. And I'm an estate planning attorney, so I found a place in my profession where I could use, like you said, both sides of that brain. So I'm here to, you know, plan for people's life and their end of life, how they want to be protected during their life if they get sick, or how they want to provide for their loved ones on their death, what they want to do. And there are some structures in place to do that. There are all kinds of creative ways to design plans for people that fit their own unique needs. And that is where I can use that creative side to fill that in, because it's not just one size fits all there.
That's right. And here's the thing is I chose you as my estate lawyer, attorney. And one of the things that really hit me was you're out there looking to help children who might have special needs be cared for after their loved ones are gone. And that's really one of your prime goals, to see that they're cared for.
Exactly. So I will mention that I happen to be totally blind, and so I don't have any vision. And growing up, I had those special needs, and I needed to be cared for. As an adult, of course, I'm highly functional and I have technology to help me and I can, you know, do my own work and care for myself. However, at the same time, I recognize that there are a lot of vulnerable people in the world, whether they're children now or they're going to be adults in the future, who have disabilities that are so severe that they will be unable to work and be gainfully employed in the workforce. And it's okay if their families are around and they're providing for them. And yet, what will happen? What will happen to those people when their loved ones are no longer there to care for them? And they are deserving of care and dignity and to live out lives as fully as possible because they're human.
Right.
And so that is where I can help their families plan for that, because this is something people don't consider, right?
So what I did was I took a screenshot of your Facebook page, and it's got all the videos there. You've got plenty to look at, but it's not just looking, you're learning about it. So if anyone's interested in learning more about it, they can go to your Facebook page, the Law Office of Erin Baker Edgar. But then also there's other facets about you that are so interesting, Erin. I mean, you are well-rounded. You love science. This one here is from one of your tweets on Twitter, more planets than the stars in our galaxy, more possibilities for life exist than ever before, even if it is not life according to our limited definition.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so I get really inspired by scientists looking throughout the universe for life. And growing up, I was, you know, a big Star Trek fan. I have my dad to thank for that. He's not a scientist, but he's kind of interested in, you know, exploration and love the science fiction aspects of Star Trek and kind of the exploration aspects. And so we got involved in that. And I have been really fascinated about what types of life there could be out there, because some people say, well, there's no humans, so there's no life. But what if there were? And all life, in my opinion, is deserving of excuse me, respect. And there's life is so interesting. So the James Webb telescope is out there looking into the past of our universe and looking out into the distance and finding so many more possibilities for planets that might sustain life. And that just completely fascinates me.
Okay. And one other fascinating thing. So now we're not only looking into outer space, we're looking at inner space. And I found this other tweet that you shared, and it has to do with that you experienced a powerful and extraordinary meditation. So if you're open to shifting your reality, this is for you. So you're into meditation.
I suppose you could say that. I do practice meditation, and like anything, it's a practice. Meditation is just a more, it's just a different way of experiencing prayer.
That's awesome.
Excuse me. So you would be surprised at how many ways there are to meditate. Just like, you know, there are a lot of ways to pray. And you can be taken to very profound places within yourself through meditation that you would not otherwise think. And I think it's fairly relaxing. That's a secondary benefit.
I always find that if I'm going through, I guess, a lot of stress, if I take the time to meditate and I go back to whatever that problem was, I seem to be able to cope better and solutions arise. And sometimes the problem's already solved by the time I get back to it. So what it means to me is that it's important to have a right frame of mind when you're trying to not just solve problems, but make your goals happen, right?
Exactly.
Yeah.
Excuse me. And scientists have even tracked people's brain waves in meditation. So it's not just, you know, some spiritual woohoo out there. They've tracked people's brain waves, and they realize that people go from a beta state, which is a waking sort of consciousness in your front brain kind of state where you think all the time, down into a theta state, which is a more relaxed, you know, getting the right and left brain involved in your thought processes. So when you come back to that alpha state, you're much more relaxed and you bring some of that relaxation with you. And it allows you to kind of open up a little bit and be a lot less tense.
Oh, you know, one thing, if we can go back to the music for a second. Mm-hmm. So you compose music, or do you play music, or do you just sing?
It's interesting you should ask, because I play music a lot less than I really want to, but I'm trying to get more involved in that. I play the piano. I have a keyboard that makes all sorts of cool sounds instead of a piano. And I, you know, of course, sing. We know about that. And I have been playing around with writing lyrics to music. There are times when I will write some melodies, some small things. Nothing really is published, and I actually haven't written them down. I've recorded some things. But this year, 2022, I have set on one of my goals is to write 4 songs this year. So I haven't actually written a song or recorded anything. That is one of my goals for 2022.
Oh, that sounds wonderful. You know, I really can't wait to hear it. I hope you record it when you're doing it.
Oh, I will. Then I'll definitely keep you, apprised of what happens.
I can't wait to hear about it. Then when I'm looking at your biography, it says you're also a creative writer. So you meaning writing songs creatively? Is that what you're doing?
No, I am writing stories and novels creatively. And there is a story about that. In 2019, I participated for the first time in National Novel Writing Month, which is in November. It's a thing. It's a thing that happens. It wasn't just me that decided it. And thousands and thousands of people around the world get together online and write a 50,000 word novel in 30 days. And I did that. I did it, and I still have it.
Wait a minute. What did you just say? 50,000 what?
50,000 words in 30 days. A 50,000 word novel, because that's technically long enough to be considered a novel, I guess.
Oh,
And
what
I
did you
did
write it
that.
on? What was your subject?
Oh my goodness. So my subject, this is so funny. I wrote it on a woman who, it's like a romance novel with some paranormal elements. And so she happens to be able to talk to trees, and she inherits this orchard from her aunt, and the love of her life comes back into her life mysteriously, and I won't tell you how it ends.
Oh my gosh, that sounds perfect. I love orchards and I
So
do
it's
think
got
I
like,
can talk to trees.
yeah, so it's got like supernatural fantasy elements, which I love. It has romance, which I'm fond of, and it also has estate planning in it because she inherits this from her aunt.
Oh, that's great. It's got estate planning in it. Way to throw that in there. I love
Absolutely.
it. Yeah, I mean, I enjoy writing and I enjoy painting and I enjoy listening to music. Now, I did take piano lessons when I was a kid, and the one thing I learned from that was to sit up straight.
Good posture is very important.
Yeah. And then how to stretch my fingers for an octave from one C to the other. And
Oh.
so did you must have taken piano lessons then.
I did. And I really like I took I started taking them seriously when I was about 9, and I stopped taking them when I graduated high school because I got bored with it. And I realized that, college was coming up and I had some challenging academics ahead of me. I could only concentrate on one musical effort at a time and singing one out.
Yeah, that's right. You get one. When I went to school, I graduated with graphic design so that I knew I would have a job. And so I held on to that job and I did marketing for years and years, built websites, and so it's good to have that. So maybe when you retire, you can go
When?
singing full time or write your stories full time.
Well, I don't know. I have this feeling that I'll be working for a long time, and I haven't contemplated retirement, although I've begun saving for retirement, but not contemplating doing it yet. I have, about 20 more years in my working life left, before I probably would start considering it. And I don't know what I'd do with it. It's very interesting you should ask. Some people retire and they just focus on their hobbies. Some people retire, but they start working again at something else they really love.
Yeah.
And I have a feeling that if I retire, and stop doing estate planning, I will still work and serve the world, because that is how I am made. And most probably doing something that I love.
Yeah.
I don't know what that will be.
Yeah, but the way, it's really interesting because you are a professional lawyer, but you have all these other aspects that makes you well-rounded. And I think the most successful people out there are well-rounded because what happens when one part of your life goes downhill, you still have nine other buckets to pick from. You still have nine other things that are going great in your life. So you're
And
smart
I
that
think
way.
that really, thank you. And I didn't intend for that to happen. But what I did realize as I was. Can you hear me?
Oh, yes, I can hear you.
Okay. What I did realize as I was beginning my legal career is that I was unhappy, just doing that and not having anything else in my life that I was doing to produce benefit for others or for myself. And I was so unhappy. And I thought, well, maybe I'm just not meant to be a lawyer, but I knew that wasn't right. And as I began questing for happiness, which there's nothing wrong with doing that.
That's right.
And there's nothing wrong with making a study of happiness for yourself or for others, even though that might seem a little bit foreign to some people. I really wanted to find out what was it, you know. And what I discovered was that there are so many things that I had interests in and that made me feel a sense of joy in my life and that I could do because I had gifts in other areas, that it was very important to me to be able to manifest those gifts and have them in my life, not to detract from my own profession, but rather to make me better able to be a full person, if that makes sense,
yeah,
to access not only, you know, like my analytical skills, but also my emotional and creative skills, because whether lawyers like to admit it or not, they are just as important in the legal profession as our analytical skills. I read a quotation from a Supreme Court justice whose name escapes me at the moment, who said that 90% of his opinions were based on emotion, and the 10% left was based on what the law was. And that to me was, it helped me make that powerful shift into basically opening my heart up again and serving from the heart in whatever way that I could, that center of emotion in us.
Yeah. I think when you're a well-rounded person, it also gives you a bit of compassion and empathy for anyone around you. The more experiences you've had, and finding common ground. And I don't know, we're all connected in that way. And I know you say you believe that because I saw it somewhere on the internet. You said it. We're all connected.
I believe that every one of us at some fundamental level is connected to everyone else. And it's nothing that we can measure. It's nothing that we can quantify. But it's evidenced in people's desire to serve others when there's a catastrophe. If you think about it, we have these tornadoes around the world and stuff, or in the country or US, we have hurricanes, and people flock to disasters. Even now in the Ukraine, there are all kinds of people all over the world helping these refugees. People in different countries, you ask them, why are you helping these people? You know, and they say, well, we have to do something. Mm-hmm. Which basically means we all have a sense of empathy and compassion in us, with a few exceptions, of course. And those folks are imprisoned, most of them, thankfully.
Mentally.
But, you know, yeah, we have this sense of empathy and compassion that makes us want to help each other. And that really, to me, signifies that we're all connected in our quest to live and be the best we can be and survive and do more than survive.
Right. Thrive.
Thrive.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah, I mean, so I started painting every morning when I get up. That's the first thing I do. Mm. And it's just such a great way to start off the day. You know, do you have any tips for those people out there who are looking to find more joy? Maybe they're not feeling so up, you know, COVID just happened, whatever, tornadoes. Do you have any advice for those people to bring happiness?
Sure. One piece of advice, don't pay too much attention to the news media. It will suck you into a world of fear, and you don't want that. Stay informed, but don't take it to heart. The real big piece of advice, though, I think, is to do something that helps you connect to others. You know, with me, I have my profession. I have my music that helps me connect to others because I sing in a group of people. Do something that helps you connect with others and gives you joy at the same time. Maybe, you know, two things. If you can't find one that does one, you find the other. But I find that eventually, if you're connecting with others and learning from them and helping them and serving the world, you will find joy and happiness if you use the gifts that you were given.
As always, you are always so well-spoken. I mean, every presentation I've ever heard you give, you're just so well-spoken. It's mind-blowing.
Thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome.
I have Toastmasters International to thank for that.
Oh, Toastmasters International.
Yes.
How long were you in that program?
I was in from 2017 until just recently when the club I was in disbanded and we were having to think about what to do next. But or 2018, I guess it was. So for 4 years, it was very wonderful to be there during COVID. It was a source of connection. We met via Zoom and were able to keep it going. And it teaches the organization teaches a lot of public speaking skills and also teaches a lot about leadership and facilitation in terms of meetings and organizing, which were some unexpected skills that I gained from that.
Yeah. And I think one of the great things about it is that, you know, everybody starts somewhere, and I'm sure even the ones in Toastmasters who are really good at it, I'm sure if you just were to show up, they would probably, you know, hold your hand.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. And that is true with anything new that you try. I would submit another piece of unsolicited advice. If you're trying something new for the first time, you're probably never alone. And if you look around hard enough, you'll find someone to help you. And you may be amazed. People who are going to help you often come to you. If you're doing something you really love and enjoy, and you're putting that sense out there that you need someone, you know, God will bring them to you sometimes. I've had it happen professionally and personally.
Yeah, I've learned a lot from just this brief time of knowing you. I mean, it's just, you're headed up there to New York. So it's going to be at Carnegie Hall in June. Is that true? Mm-hmm. It's in June, right?
Right.
And I know the conductor and composer, Michael Glasgow, is so excited. I spoke with him briefly, and so I'm going to try and have him on Tuesday. So I hope you join us for that one. That's going to be something. But maybe you could do... do you have anything else? I don't want to put you on the spot, but do you have anything else you could sing for us?
Let's see. So I do have this other thing, and I've been singing it ever since I was young. Maybe it was sung at Veronica's wedding. It's one of these other like Catholic songs that come up a lot. It's called Bread of Angels, and it's not in English, and I don't know what it all means, but it's a nice sort of pretty little peaceful tune. So, Panis Angelicus, fit Panis Hominum, dat Panis Celicus figuris terminum.
Wow, it sounds like an angel.
Actually, Bread of Angels, that's what it's called.
It really does. It sounds like an angel. Does. I can't even imagine what this is going to sound like if you all are singing that beautiful music, what it's going to sound like in that hall.
Oh, it'll be glorious. I just know
it. Oh, you got
it.
Another heart. Somebody just put another Aww. Heart up there. So there you go. You got some love coming your way, Erin.
Got some hearts.
Well, best wishes to you. Is there anything Thank else you want to cover?
I just want to say to those people out there who have dreams, it's never too late. You're never too old. You never know where the opportunity is going to come from. And keep watching Lisa's show. She is full of joy and laughter, and she'll get you into that dream.
I'm going to give it a try. All right. Well, you take care, Erin. Thanks for joining.
Thank you.